Hello everyone and welcome to another podcast episode on M&D Fantasy Corner. I'm Duncan and with me, as always, is my friend Momo.
Hello everybody! I cannot believe that we are starting. I think we can call it third season.
It's third season, man. I swear it's like yesterday we started. Actually, I don't know if we ever said this to people, but me and Momo first recorded like almost full book once.
Not even close.
Recorded... I think it was close to finished, first book, man.
No, I think we were a little bit over half.
But either way, man, and we deleted all this footage, because we didn't like it.
You know what is funniest to me? When I listened to our first episodes, they sound like shit to me again.
I'm also not happy with our first episode. I'm sometimes not happy even with our, you know, now episodes. But
man, you know, in general, I have feeling that we kind of improved a bit. But when I'm listening those previous episodes, the thing that bothers me the most is are actually production value, like, you know, sound and quality of sound. I'm not saying
that
now
it's also improve.
I'm not saying that now is good enough, but definitely it's much better than it used to be.
But anyways, I just want to also say thank you to Dejan Delić for allowing us to use his art for free. So this is third season we are. This is third artist that's allowing his art, and I think these are the only three guys that are consistently making art for Malazan. I don't think I ever saw the fourth person who has this much art.
Thing is, man, after you know, for first season we use Shadan art, for second we use Corporal Knobs, and you know after that I knew that you know for next book I will ask Dejan Delić for permission. Because those three guys are like holy trinity of Malazan art, in my opinion.
Yes, I agree 100%. So once again, man, thank you. Thank you to, you know, those other two guys also from allowing us to use it before.
Best thing is, man, that they all three have like very different styles.
Yes, you can recognize it.
Exactly. Especially Dejan have kinda very, very unique style. But anyway, before we also start, I wanna, you know, mention a couple of things for previous episode. First is, man, that when I was reading, I'm not even sure who wrote that comment. He mentioned something that I swear, man, I wanted to slap myself for not mentioning it. Thing that he likes the most about Malazan is that it doesn't have main character. And thing is, man, that is one of my favorite things too. And you know, I even had speech prepared about that, about how I feel that in Malazan, like, world is kinda main character, setting is main character, not anybody, you know, any of the actual characters. And I fucking forgot to, you know, speak anything about that.
Man, when I read that comment also, I thought the same thing, because this is the one of the most unique aspects of Malazan, not having a main character. That's crazy. It's crazy concept. I don't think any book has it like this. But overall, I think we should start with this episode.
This prologue is like extremely, extremely important and packed with information. This is perhaps, as you know, most important prologue in all 10 books, maybe.
This is, I want to give suggestion to people who are first time reader. As you know, this is how important this prologue is. I want you to read it. That's first step. Second step, read it again. Third step, read it one more time. And when you think that you have all details from this prologue in your head, maybe listen to our episode, and then go again and reread this prologue. That's how many details it contains. And that's how important this prologue is.
And not only for this book. This is why I said most important prologue in all the books. Because this is like important for each and every book of this series. There was not a single piece of information here that was useless, man. That's the thing.
Pay attention to the... We're gonna try to deconstruct it. We're gonna mention pretty much every detail that's written here, but we are not gonna spoiler anything. So you are safe in that. But pay attention to details.
I'll try my best, man, but there are a couple of things that I'm really not sure. I'm not sure how to approach. But you know, first let's start with one character that we actually met in first book, and this is bone caster, Franco. I don't know how to pronounce it.
Yes, do you remember him? I hope that you guys remember this guy was in Dream of Krupp.
And you know, basically, because of that, this Franco, he knows he will live for a long time. And he know that they will, you know, do this ritual. So, you know, I hope you guys connected that. Second very important thing is that this event that is happening here is marking the end of Jagut War.
It's marking the end of 33rd Jagut War, and it's this war was only on one continent, which we realize which continent this was in the chapter 1. So, I don't know, I can just say it probably. Yes. This was basically on Janabakis.
Yes.
So they are exterminating Jagut, but on Janabakis.
Yes. But also what's kind of an important character that we meet is another bone caster. And, you know, she's sister of somebody very important.
It's Tool. Basically, he's one of the most important characters from book 1. Yes. You remember, guys, Tula Animas from book 1? I hope that a lot of you didn't already forget that cast.
I don't know. I wouldn't hold it against you if you did. But, you know, she's very different than Tool. She kind of don't want to do this ritual. And she's also clownless.
The thing that is very strange about Killava is that she is your anti-Tila Animas of that time. For example, they were all eager to hunt Jagut, and they were all eager to do this ritual to become immortal. Killava was different, and you can see this in prologue, that she is, first of all, she is opposing killing of them, she is having second thoughts, she wants to save these children, so she is having, like, you know,
but
conscience.
She fucked it up, like, majorly, man.
We will get to that. But second thing is you can see also here that she do not want this ritual. She's opposed to that too. So she is very different Tila Animas compared to these others.
Yes. And apparently, man, these Tila Animas, even though, you know, we read always, I at least up so far, that they kind of live like one with nature and shit like that. It was kind of all bullshit, man. They exterminated pretty much everything. Same like humans, basically.
Yes, but there is another hint how similar actually humans are to Tula Animas. Their empire, for example, Tul, Onos Tulan, he was first sword. And I don't know if you guys remember, but this was mentioned a few times, even Malazan Empire had first sword. So humans kind of adopted a lot of culture from Tula Animas.
Exactly.
Okay, so shall we jump into the second part of prologue, which has ton of details, ton of informations. Like I said, guys, reread,
yes,
and focus on details.
And here we meet three elder gods. So far, you know, one of these is known to us, and that is Krul. Second is Draconus, and third is Cold Sister of the Cold Knights. Here we start little game, guys. And you know, your job is to figure out who this Sister of the Cold Knights is. She was already mentioned, and there are enough information here that you can deduce who she is. Shall we first speak a little bit about her?
Okay, let's talk about her.
Okay, first hint is her name. Sister of the Cold Knights. Think book 1. I'll not say more about that, okay?
Okay.
Second hint is when Kalor is speaking to her, and he say that, you know, she's usually walking among mortals, playing the role of middling sorceress. That is second strong hint of who she is. Third hint is Kalor actual curse on her. What is his curse?
She will be ripped apart, and she will not have respite.
Not only that, but how... By whom she will be ripped apart?
By something, like, I don't know how it was written. Was it like something alien?
No, it is, I think, said in that she will be ripped apart by unhuman hands upon a field of battle. And last hint is when, you know, Krul, Draconus and her, when they are speaking after all these events, they are saying to her that she need to find companion who will be loyal to her. And with all these hints, I think you guys should be able to figure out who she is.
I agree with this. But if you do not figure out who she is, it's fine.
It's not fine. It's not fine. You gotta figure out.
Yeah, I'm just saying to you guys, it's fine. Don't listen to Momo. And you will anyway find out who this is.
Another game, guys. But you know, this one I think is a little bit easier because, you know, it's mentioned outright, is Color. Couple of things here. First of all, we heard that name, right?
Of course.
We heard it in book 1 and book 2 also. Where did we hear it in book 2, man?
So you wanna go first with book 2?
Okay, let's go from book 1. Who is Color in book 1?
Well, he was the dude that was speaking with Caladan Brood in one of the chapters. And he was also like his second in command against Malazan.
Exactly. And in book 2?
In book 2, we saw his sigil inside of one very particular Warren.
Imperial Warren.
Yes, that was very familiar. This Warren should be very familiar to you after reading this prologue.
And that Warren seemed dead. And Kalam at one point find like shitload of bones and skulls, I think, in it.
You also need to realize how it was represented. Like, for example, here, when they were walking towards him, he was sitting on a pile of ash. You know, like something is burned.
So basically, guys, you know, let's stop, you know, beating around the bush. This, what Krul did to save this continent that Kalor incinerated, that is basically Imperial Warren. That's what we are trying to say without saying it, you know. I cannot hold myself in check anymore.
Oh, this was pretty clear. So now we know few really key important things about Kalor. It's basically that long time ago, he's super old. Long time ago, he was extremely powerful, like almost like tyrant. I think he is tyrant, controlling over multiple millions of people.
And you know, it's even pointed out that even, you know, Jagut tyrants, they're not even close and didn't even have, you know, close subjects as Kalor had. And man, those people were so desperate that they did something, some event that is extremely, extremely important for the future of this entire universe.
One of the most important also, guys, things to do right now is to realize on what island was Kalor ruling. They said it's called, I'm afraid to even pronounce this, it's called Yatsuruku.
Yeah, something like that.
And so this island, you need to go to your map and find where it is. Because, you know, to me it's weird if somebody is like, I don't know, reading book and doesn't know where stuff is happening. So, you know, guys, you need to find good map.
That was shot in my direction.
Yeah, you know, but you know, even without reading, because after some time, you guys will realize everything. But to me, for example, when you are first time reader, why wouldn't you get good quality map and know where the stuff is happening? So this, where Kalor is reigning, it's called Yatsuruku. Find it on the map so you know roughly where the events are happening.
I know, basically, those people were so fed up that they decided to call some foreign god to help them. But
yes,
man,
that didn't
go as planned. Man, they opened some, I don't know how to call it.
They did some ritual.
Yes.
And they tried to summon this foreign god.
They didn't summon him. They they got him curious of what is happening there. And when he got close, they like trapped him and pulled him into their, I don't know how to call it, universe, dimension or whatever. And man, that didn't go nice. He was kinda destroyed in process. But when I say destroy, I mean literally destroyed.
I just want to say there is a little also tiny detail here.
Yes.
Where I do not want to, or do we spoiler this? Probably, it's kinda spoiler. Here is the thing, how it was described in this prologue, there were maggots. And Krul, I think it was Krul who said this, that he noticed what they became. And they had big dark wings, So this will be your first hint. And second hint is that they cackle.
Yes. And who
so
cackles?
So what could that be?
Who cackles the best?
So those are two hints. Big black wings and cackling. So put those two together and you can figure out what was birthed also by this event.
Yes. And another thing, you know, of course, these three elder gods curse Kalor. But what is more like amazing to me, that like sacrificing these, you know, I think 7 million souls or something, they point out, it gave Kalor power. He fucking cursed them back. But I don't think he would be able to do that if he didn't slaughter these 7 million people.
Thing is, Kalor is definitely a powerful dude. You do not get to enslave millions of people by being weak. Also, there's another thing. He had skirmish with another being they mentioned here called Ardata. And you will learn, I don't know in what book, but definitely in one of the later books you will learn who Ardata is.
Yes. I know.
So this Kalor, he's not, like, he was not also afraid. Like, when you read this moment, when Cruel Draconis and, I almost said her name.
Sister of Cold Knights.
Sister of Cold Knights. When they were approaching, like, you know, he was nonchalantly sitting on his throne. So he's not afraid.
Yeah.
But that wasn't really smart. Because man, the way they cursed him,
it's fucked
it wasn't
up.
Nice.
Man, you know, when they are discussing, and you know, Cruel is saying for how long, and you know, somebody respond, long.
So basically his curse is that he will never ascend, but he will also be mortal forever.
No, he's gonna be aging. His first curse is that he will be immortal. But he will age and he will like feel wounds and everything.
Yeah.
Second is that he will never ascend. And third is that he will kind of never hold power, I think. That whatever he do will kind of fall to dust, basically.
It will fail.
Yes. So you know, for somebody like Kalor, who is obviously guy who wants...
Ambitious.
Yes. Who is ambitious, this is terrible curse. But man, he fucked them back too.
But shall we now deconstruct the two curses that he casted on characters that we kinda know who they are?
Man, thing is, you know, about Cruel, it's fairly easy, man. And you know, we already saw that it kinda came true. He cursed
He just said that he will be forgotten, and we know from the book one that Cruel was basically forgotten, almost like he became non-existent.
Yes. And we can actually even speak about Draconis, because in chapter 1, it's discovered a little bit more about him. It is discovered that, you know, when Kalor said that his creation will be turned against him, that meant, you know, that Draconis is actually creator of Dragnipur.
Yes, that's explained
and, you know,
in chapter 1.
Anomander slayed him with Dragnipur. And, you know, third, we also know that it's true, because it actually happened. Amici. Man, this Sister of Cold Knights.
Oh, we already talked about that.
Yes, we already talked about that. And you know, another hint that this actually happened somewhere, guys. Already. We saw it. And also another important thing is that this act of Cruel trying, you know, to heal this continent by putting it inside the Warren, kinda, you know, scarred him for life. Very important thing to notice.
There's another thing that I want to say also, that's another thing that should be noticed, detail, that all of this was being observed by a beast, by some being that is, according to him, he is ancient even to these elder gods.
You know, man, what? I remember I was fucked up when I was first reading this, because in first book we are reading there are gods, there are ascendants, there is, you know, it's very complicated, and then came Cruel and he's like, these children gods, they don't know shit. And now I'm reading this and Cruel Draconis and this Sister of Cold Knights, they are walking, they are elder gods, they are powerful beyond imagination, and there's some wolf watching them and saying, oh, these children gods, these fucking noobs. There is like always fucking higher level, man.
One of the things that is also important, another detail that you need to realize when you read this, that this beast lost eye because of that event that we talked before.
Yes. And he's looking and he's looking for somebody.
And he moved somewhere. And then now, so this was like many thousands of years ago. And now we are going back to chapter one, and this being appeared, and guess who it found?
Man, you know, I remember when I was first reading it, and I think there is even sentence when, you know, he's looking at this mortal, and like he see mirror of himself, and I'm thinking, no, oh, that's some guy with full face, what the fuck? And then I realize it's fucking Tok. I was so happy, man, that Tok is back.
Yes, and this should be also a hint to you guys to where this being all these thousands of years ago, where he went.
Yes.
Where this beast went.
It was Chaos.
Where was Tok?
Chaos Warren.
It was Chaos Warren. And do you know how we know that he was in Chaos Warren?
Because Herlock threw him there.
Exactly. Crazy Herlock. He was kind of navigating through Chaos Warren. So that's big important little detail that you guys need to connect.
So, you know, guys, just, you know, notice that there is definitely connection between Tok and this wolf.
Yep, and they got out from this Chaos Warren.
Yes.
I mean, you know, Tok is out of this.
And I think this is beginning of, like, new bromance of Malazan, one of the many. And that is
definitely.
Tok. And that is Tok and Tool. Oh, if you guys didn't notice till now, I think you should, that, you know, this is all about, you know, like, I don't know how to call them, friendships, but, you know, like, between two dudes, mostly. We have already Ikarium and Mappo, we have Fiddler and Hedge, Callum, Quickban.
Now Malik Murillo.
Yes, Malik Murillo. Now we have... beginning.
Amenaz Cotillion.
Yes. Oh, man, every time, you know, I'm saying to myself, okay, that is it. And then you mention another one. There are many. And there will be many more in this book that will be formed.
Tehol and Bug.
Oh, man, that's spoiler. also, man, oh, one certain Tistedur and another Tlanimas in future.
But do you guys now understand why did I put... In our thumbnails, there are two lines. That, you know, it's not random that we put those two lines. They represent, like, some duality. I don't know. I always felt that it's important for this book.
Yeah, and, you know, they meet also somebody very important, and that is daughter of Draconis. And, you know, Draconis apparently had, you know, flair for theatrics. Because he fucking named his two daughters Envy and Spite. What a beautiful names.
But do you know what was badass to me here?
What?
Segule.
Man, first time when I was reading, I was like, who the fuck are they? Why is Tok so impressed? But, you know, more when you realize more about Segule, then I wanna say something. You know, these three Segule, you are thinking, who are they? But what you don't guys realize that this is army. This is Army of Segule. I think, you know, I'll leave it to that for now. But, you know, think about that.
I just want to say a little bit about Segule because it's explained here, but not really clearly. But I want to, you know, to prepare you guys for this. They are some crazy society. And this society is sorted by rankings. And these rankings are determined by duels. So that's, to me, at least, when I was first time reading, it was epic. I didn't expect it. Like, I don't know why, but simply it was amazing to me. And apparently, according to this first chapter, there are some hints that you can read rank of these Segule from the mask. We will come to that later, and we will talk about these rankings. You're gonna be surprised by these Segules a lot, guys. And apparently, you know, one of them is... badly wanna clash with Tool, So we can look forward to see how first sword of Tlanimas is he good? Is he any good? We will see.
Oh, I expect him, you know, I expected him to be good, but you know, we will see. Also here we meet another set of characters, and that is Gruntle, Stoney and Harlow, and their, I don't know, employer who doesn't have good imagination about giving name to himself.
Okay, we will leave it at that.
Yes, we will leave it at that. Their, you know, merchant Caruli, who is like surprisingly knowledgeable about many things, but he doesn't understand price of things, man. I don't know if you noticed that.
I noticed.
You know everything else, but you know, Gretel speaking to him like, you know, reason why you're paying us this much is because we are capable, and he's like, what you are charging me is much? Oh, good to know. Good to know.
Oh yeah, but also you remember, guys, in the book 2 we told you that we are going to tell you if some characters are extremely important.
Hey, Gruntle, guys.
And you know, Gruntle, Harlow, Stoney, they are all fairly important.
You know who
so
is
you
also
need to pay
important,
attention.
Man?
Who?
A man. Fucking, oh, I'm afraid to, oh man, I was so hyped to say his name, and then my brain said, oh man, you will butcher it. Korbal, Brochen, Bauchelain.
Yeah, that's pretty good. Bauchelain and Korbal Brooch.
And man, you know, they are so important, guys, that they have a couple of books by themselves.
Actually, they are like little books.
Yeah,
I think they are
novellas. Yes. About their adventures. And you know, if you guys didn't notice it, that even somebody as Gruntle doesn't feel comfortable around these two guys, man. They are fucking nasty. There is aura around them that doesn't smell good, like. I don't know how
thing
to
is,
explain.
Of course, these creeps, they wanted to enter inside of Azad house.
Yes.
So, that's important. And also, there is one, like, saying, and I cannot remember, I don't know why, but I cannot remember where I got this saying. But when Gruntle turned around, they offered him job and he turned around. And I remember this saying, in dangerous jobs, guys, there are two types of people. There is bold and there is old. And you cannot be both.
Yeah.
And Gruntle is old, guys. And you see here why.
You know
why,
man,
he's old.
You know, I kind of like this Gruntle from the very beginning. But I remember this clearly. That, you know, one sentence where I say, when I said to myself, okay, I will like this guy. When Bauchelain is shitting to him, he's pointing to this hole, this burrow, and he's saying to him, do you know what this is? And his response, man, do you remember it?
I cannot remember.
Yeah, it's a hole in the ground. Like, you know, he's like straight shooter, man. He's not shitting. And I really like, you know, I liked his opinion about gods, man. I have a feeling that he doesn't like them. He just wanna be as far away from them as possible.
Basically, he's not bold guy.
Yes. And you know, this all, you know, like, it is described where they are, it's fucking destruction everywhere. And you know, this is all Rise doing, guys. From book one. I hope you connected that.
Yes, basically now we are shifting back to Janabakis and events are rolling there. You know, they are just picking up right where we left them off in book one.
Yes, and you know, just couple of things is keep your eye on Caruli, keep your eye whenever there is Gruntle, and keep your eyes on these two fucking guys.
Yeah, I think that was really good episode.
Was that all?
That should be all.
Okay, then, you know, this is it. I thought we had some more to speak about, but apparently, you know, we didn't. Anyway, guys, I hope, you know, I hope we didn't forget something, because this prologue and this first chapter are fucking jam-packed with information. I hope we didn't overlook something. If we did, you know, tell us. And you know, I really hope you will enjoy this, and see you next week.